Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary was the one who anointed the Lord with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair. Her brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent a message to Jesus, "Lord, he whom you love is ill." But when Jesus heard it, he said, "This illness does not lead to death. Rather, it is for God's glory, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it." Accordingly, though Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, after having heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then, after this, he said to the disciples, "Let us go to Judea again." The disciples said to him, "Rabbi, the Jews were just now trying to stone you, and are you going there again?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours of daylight? Those who walk during the day do not stumble, because they see the light of this world. But those who walk at night stumble, because the light is not in them." After saying this, he told them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to awaken him." The disciples said to him, "Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will be all right." Jesus, however, had been speaking about his death, but they thought he was really referring merely to sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." Thomas, who was called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." When she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary and told her privately, "The teacher is here and is calling for you." And when she heard it, she got up quickly and went to him. Now, Jesus had not yet come to the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. The Jews who were with her in the house, consoling her, saw Mary get up quickly and go out. They followed her because they thought she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench, because he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, But I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me. When he had said this, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out! The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, Unbind him and let him go. Many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what Jesus did, believed in him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
May what I preach this morning be helpful to you and give glory to God. Amen. Please be seated. During the three-year cycle of Sunday readings, we hear from Isaiah, we hear from Jeremiah, we hear from other prophets, and the subject is often about Israel being in exile. This morning, we hear from Ezekiel, speaking on the same topic. The passage paints a pretty bleak picture of what being in exile feels like, and Ezekiel brings us a word of hope, maybe even a promise. This reading doesn't make a lick of sense unless we understand how devastating the exile was. Before the attacks that led to defeat, Israel had a long history in which they considered themselves God's people. Long, long ago, God and Moses had led the enslaved Israelites out of Egypt, and over a period of 40 years in the wilderness had formed them as the people of God. They were God's people, and God was their God. God provided for them, and they mostly obeyed the rules God set out for them in the commandments. Over time, the people came to believe that as long as they followed the rules, things would go smoothly. When bad things happened, like droughts, attacks by foreigners, natural calamities, the people were sure God was displeased with them and their behavior, so they repented, promised to live better, more godly lives, and things settled down again. Other than a few annoying prophets threatening total destruction because people were not following the rules carefully enough, life moved along reasonably smoothly for years and years and years, actually for centuries. And then the Assyrians attacked the northern kingdom, took control of all the land, and scattered the Israelites throughout the Assyrian Empire. Shortly thereafter, the Babylonians captured the rest of the country, including Jerusalem. You remember Jerusalem, where the temple was. The temple with its Holy of Holies, where only the high priest was allowed to enter. The temple that housed the glory of God. The temple which was the goal of every Israelite on pilgrimage. That temple is now in ruins. Legend says not a rock was left on another rock. The Babylonians destroyed it and carried the entire population off to Babylon. One of the commentaries I read this week said that it's difficult to exaggerate how serious the exile was as a national disaster and as a crisis of faith. The people had lost the land promised to Moses, the land to which Abraham had journeyed and taken up residency, the land Isaac returned to with his wives, Leah and Rachel, and the land Isaac left when Esau was after him, and the land to which he returned much later in life. Way back in history, the people had asked God for a king like the other countries had. The prophet Samuel discouraged them But they insisted, and God appointed a king to rule over them. There had been king after king after king. Some pretty awful, some pretty wonderful, many of them just kind of mediocre. But they had all been called by God, all installed as God's king by a prophet. And now the king was taken captive, and the temple lay in ruins, and their land belonged to a foreign country. Small wonder the exiles asked themselves if their history as Yahweh's people had come to an end. This morning's reading, the vision of the valley of dry bones, is the prophetic answer to that question. Please notice it is not just the valley of dry bones, it's the vision that occurred there, the vision that Ezekiel shares with the people in exile. Ezekiel reports that he was taken by the Spirit of the Lord and set down in the middle of a great plain covered with bones. Dry, dry bones. Human bones. Nothing left of those bodies but the barest, driest bone. A dialogue occurs in the vision, a dialogue between Ezekiel and Yahweh. Clearly, what Ezekiel hears is important. It's the word of the Lord, a message for God's people by way of Ezekiel. The vision moves from a description of what was seen to a report of what was heard and experienced. God tells Ezekiel to prophesy to the bones, and Ezekiel does as instructed. And the words he speaks begin to happen right before his eyes. The bones have become bodies, bodies without breath. After more instruction and prophesying, the breath comes from the four winds, filling the bodies. The bones that became lifeless bodies are now living, breathing people. The vision concludes with a message from God for Ezekiel to deliver to the exiles. These bones are the entire house of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up and our hope has perished. We are completely finished. I will bring you to Israel's fertile land. I will put my breath in you and you will live. I will plant you on your fertile land and you will know that I am the Lord. I've spoken and I will do it. The word of God prophesied by Ezekiel, the Spirit of God by way of the four winds, will revive God's people. Yes, they are exiles in a foreign land. And yes, the temple is destroyed. And no, God is not yet done with God's people. They will return home, and until they do, God is with them right where they are. Given the destruction and the despair of the exile, these words had to be reassuring. But I wonder if there were folks who were so hopeless, so filled with despair, that they just couldn't risk believing what they heard from Ezekiel. No matter how wonderful it sounded, I wonder if they were afraid of being disappointed again. Disappointed. Mary and Martha were certainly disappointed. They might even have been angry. They had sent word to Jesus that his friend, their brother Lazarus, was sick. And Jesus didn't come. Lazarus died. Finally, 4 days later, Jesus comes to Bethany and calls Lazarus to come out of the tomb. And Lazarus does just that. I wish the gospel story you heard this morning was that simple and succinct. It is not. There's a whole bunch of conversation between several pairs of people. Parts of the conversation make sense to me. Parts of it do not. The story feels choppy and sometimes a little disconnected. If I'm feeling really grumpy, I mutter something about the folks who believed at the end of the story who didn't know about most of that story, and so why did I have to hear it all? Setting all that aside, I do have a couple of thoughts. The first is to tell you that when I encounter a story that feels this complicated, confusing, and hard to follow, I listen for the parts that stay with me when I am finished. finished reading. This time, Mary and Martha stuck with me when the story was over, when I had walked away to make another cup of coffee. I could easily picture them talking with Jesus, asking him why he hadn't come sooner. "We sent you word. We knew you could heal him. We sent you word. Why didn't you come?" Jesus, weeping with Mary, makes much more sense to me than the theological conversation Jesus had with Martha when she asked him that same question. I've asked God that kind of question. Maybe you have too. Why? Where were you? Couldn't you have done something? There are questions I have had for a very long time that are still waiting for answers. I joke about having a list for when I get to heaven. My guess is that I will totally forget about the list when I get there. In the meantime, I am faced with a choice every day. How do I choose to respond to the things I do not understand? What do I do with what looks like unanswered prayer? My response varies from day to day. What doesn't vary is God. I am sure beyond a doubt that I am loved regardless of my questions, and I am sure that God is God and I am not, and that is a very good thing. So today we have two stories about people trying to deal with their current circumstances. The Israelites had good reason to worry that there was no hope for their former relationship with God. They had been captured. They were living in a foreign land. Did God even know where they were? More importantly, did God care? Ezekiel brings God's word to God's people. "Yes, I know where you are. And yes, I am still your God. And I will bring you home." Mary and Martha sent word to Jesus that Lazarus was sick. Jesus didn't come. Lazarus died and was buried. By the time Jesus got there, Lazarus had been in the tomb for 4 days. It was too late for Lazarus to be healed. Jesus believes otherwise. He calls Lazarus to come out of the tomb, and Lazarus does. These stories are a part of our history. The people in these stories are our people. And what we learn in these stories is true for us, too. And this is what I think we learn, or at least part of what we learn. It is never too late, and there is always hope. Things may resolve differently than we had hoped, and they may be different than what we expected, but God is always involved. It is never too late. There is always hope. There are no exceptions, only the limitations that we choose to accept. Today is the 5th Sunday of Lent. With God, all things are possible. It is never too late. There is always hope. Carry that with you as you prepare for and enter into Palm Sunday, Holy Week, Good Friday,